But the guides have said, that I work with, have said, you know, we've been on a planet with war for so long that we expect it. And we're always getting what we expect. We're creating out of a sense of history in a common field. And they've said until humanity moves to a level of consciousness where war is not a possibility, we are going to have it. But they do say that we're actually having to see our own creation. So in the very first book they dictated, which was called I Am the Word, which was, you know, spoken through me in, I think, 2009, the guide said, humanity is at a time of reckoning, and a reckoning is a facing of oneself and all of one's creations. And everything that's been created in fear needs to be recreated in a higher way.
I'd like to welcome back to the show returning champion, Paul Selig. How you doing, Paul?
I'm good. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much for coming back on the show, my friend. It is always a pleasure to talk to you in the guides. And we're going to be talking today a bunch about your new book, The Book of Innocence, which apparently you put out, what, a book every other month, Mr. King?
It's about one a year it's been, yeah.
It's. I mean, I think last time you were on the show, you had a book. So I think it was like, did you sneak two in this year? Or was it just the one?
Well, they generally come out in the fall. So September last year, there was a book. And yeah. This year, there was a book. And they've already finished the next one, which they say is actually the final book in this series of 12 books. So,
oh, wow.
Yeah. There's more, but this teaching is completing itself.
Wow. That's fantastic. Yeah. I mean, other than Stephen King, I think you're one of the most prolific writers. And Jane Patterson.
I don't write a thing. I sit in a chair, I close my eyes, and I take dictation. It's all spoken, no writing.
So, okay. So for people who don't know your work and who you are, can you talk a little bit about what you do as far as a channel is concerned, what makes you kind of unique in the channeling world?
I don't know. You know, I don't follow other channels' work, truthfully, so I can't really compare. I know how I work, and I know what's happened through me. I'm a channel for a collective. They call themselves the guides, or I call them the guides. That's how they got the name, the guides. They have another name that they'll use, which is Melchizedek on occasion. They'll say, this is, if you want to call us something, you can call us this. But, you know, the guides dictate entire books through me, and all of the books, and there are now 12 that are completed and 11 in print, are the unedited transcripts of the dictations that come through. So the first book took 2.5 weeks and of sittings, and the last book maybe took, I don't know, 4 weeks or 5 weeks of sittings, because I wasn't doing it for, you know, every day for 3 or 4 hours. But what makes me different, I don't know. You know, there's an energy that comes through when the guides I work with teach, which is very palpable, and they're working with energetic attunements that support the reader or the student in operating at a higher level of vibration or alignment, which they say claims a new experience of being. You know, when you lift to a level of co-resonance with source, where you're more operative at that level, you're moving beyond some of the common structures that we've been taught through, fear and rage and selfishness and the kinds of things that we've sort of been indoctrinated through, you know, historically. And so I suppose what makes me different is I just keep showing up for this stuff, even though I didn't really ask to do it. And I may never fully understand it, and I'm grateful for it, but I'm a student of the work. You know, I'm not a spiritual teacher. I'm not a guru. I'm a radio, and I think of myself as a radio. And when I'm tuned into the guides as the station, my real job is to convey accurate information as I'm hearing it. It's stenography, really, if you think of it that way. When I do psychic reading, which is a little different, I'm tuned into the person I'm reading for, and they become the station that I tune into, or the people that they ask about.
Now, we had the pleasure of meeting in person last year, or actually this year, actually it was this year. Yeah. And you were doing a live, kind of like a live seminar, if you will. Mm-hmm. Remind me, during those live sittings, are those materials for the book as well when you do these kind of sittings?
That one wasn't, but the last eight books or so were all sort of dictated in front of audiences entirely. So the last book was done in public events in Berkeley, California, in Boone, North Carolina, at a group that I convened on Maui, and on live streams, you know. So depending on how long the book takes, that's how many events we try to line up in a row. Usually, you know, for the month of August and September, beginning of September, I'm channeling a lot because that's when the books have been coming. So we try to schedule events so that the guides can do, in a day long workshop, they can do, you know, three lectures for a book or 20 pages. In a 5-day event, they can do 70, 80 pages of material. And it's nice for me to have the continuity of the same audience there for a number of sessions because the books are building, the teachings are building one upon the next. But they're going to do what they're going to do anyway. So, yeah.
And I'd imagine that's a little bit easier on you doing it in front of an audience than just sitting in a room with somebody dictating it or recording it?
Well, the first three books, I think, maybe were done. I was on the phone with a woman in Berkeley. I was recording in my end. She was taking notes. And I would transcribe those CDs. It was a CD recorder in those days, and that's how I would do it. And now I don't transcribe anything at all. The videotape gets sent off, and there are people that do it, and somebody that proofs it against the recordings. I prefer doing it in front of an audience because the energy is so high. There was an elegance to doing it with one person because the guides were really teaching the one person in the chair as the student or the student in proxy for all of the students. And when you have 100 or people in a room or 500 people online, the guides are speaking to a larger group. But it's the same teaching, and you really can't tell the difference once you see it all transcribed, you know, what was done for a small group of students or what was done for a larger one.
So before we get into the book, Paul, I wanted to ask you, this is a question I've been getting messaged a lot about, that, you know, we've talked on the show before about humanity's consciousness shift, and that we're all shifting, that things are getting better. We are becoming more evolved. We're getting closer to a higher vibration. And yet we are starting to see and have seen, but more currently starting to see some remarkably horrible things happening in the Middle East, things happening in the Ukraine, these kind of conflicts that are happening are amping up this hate and division, where that's been going on, I think, probably for the last 8 years, almost 10 years, you've started to see that kind of like things that were under the ground started to bubble up, racism, things like that. What do the guides say about, not specifically of what is happening currently, but this energy, how does this coincide with what we're supposed to be doing with this shift in humanity's consciousness?
Unfortunately, I want to suggest that I think it's part of it because nothing gets addressed until it's first seen. So you're saying you have the last 10 years, but the guides have said that I work with have said, you know, we've been on a planet with war for so long that we expect it. And we're always getting what we expect. We're creating out of a sense of history in a common field. And they've said until humanity moves to a level of consciousness where war is not a possibility, we are going to have it. But they do say that we're actually having to see our own creation. So in the very first book they dictated, which was called I Am the Word, which was, you know, spoken through me in, I think, 2009, the guide said, humanity is at a time of reckoning, and a reckoning is a facing of oneself and all of one's creations. And everything that's been created in fear needs to be recreated in a higher way. And in the Book of Truth, which they dictated very shortly before the presidential election and what, you know, six, 8 years ago, whatever it was now, the guide said, everything that's been buried is going to be brought to the surface. And that means what was buried in the backyard 5 years ago and was buried 2,000 years ago. And if you want to look at your backyard as an excavation site, it's going to be a mess. And the purpose of seeing all this stuff isn't to point fingers or to make someone or something wrong. It's to see it anew or to move to a higher level of perception around these things so that we don't continue to replicate it. The guides have said a lot. I'll go to them in a minute and see if they want to come through, because I may be getting it all wrong given your question. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the guides have said, you know, we can learn through the folly of war. You can learn the futility of war until there's no one left standing if you want to learn that way. And we have free will, and we're the ones choosing this. But I do get a couple of things that I think are important. One is, you know, I don't think that I, Paul, or you, Alex, create everything. I don't know. I didn't, you know. But I do think that we're operating in a common field where how we perceive something and how we claim it or relate to it supports the structure of the thing. The guides have said many, many, many times, what you put in darkness or who you put in darkness calls you to that darkness, which is a teaching of vibrational accord, or what you damn or who you damn damns you back. And it's not that they're doing anything, that that's the level of alignment you're holding. You cannot be the light and hold another in darkness. They've said it many, many, many times. And I suspect a lot of what's happening right now is this is what's been under the rug. This stuff isn't new. This stuff is very, very, very old. And until we really address it, I think we're going to have big problems. And if we can begin to look at this as an opportunity, I suspect that there's hope through this. Let me see if they want to say anything. And, you know, for those people who haven't heard me channel, it's not elegant. I whisper and I repeat and it sounds stupid, but it's just how it comes through, and I'm on my second cup of coffee, so we'll see if anything comes at all. We'd like to address this. They're saying we would like to address this. You stand at a precipice. You stand at a precipice. How do you wish to live? How do you wish to live? How do you wish to love? How do you wish to love? How do you wish to divide? How do you wish to divide? The divisions are yours. You see, the divisions are yours. You see, a border is a creation. A border is a creation, as is a nationality, as is a nationality, as is a religion, as is a religion. These are creations of man. These are creations of man. You abide in separation. You abide in separation. You build walls. You build walls. You erect borders. You erect borders. And you wonder why you fight. And then you wonder why you fight until you realize you are one. Until you realize you are one, realize means no. Realize means no. You will find fault. You will find fault. You will find ways to separate. You will find ways to separate. The choice, in fact, finally is yours. The choice, in fact, finally is yours. Now, as we have said, humanity is moving through this. Humanity is moving through this at a very quick pace. At a very quick pace. The decibels higher. The decibel is higher. The tone is higher. The tone is higher. The frequency is shifting quickly. The frequency is shifting quickly. And all things were claimed in fear. And all things that were claimed in fear are now being seen. Are now being seen. So they may be seen anew. So that they may be seen anew. To see something anew. To see something anew is not to improve it. Is not to improve it. It's to reclaim it. It's to reclaim it in source. In source. Now source is not a god. Now source is not a god that does what you want. That does what you want. Source is the one note sung. Source is the one note sung that is in manifestation, that is in manifestation, as all you see, and in fact, all you can imagine, and in fact, all you can imagine. When you claim the one note sung, when you claim the one note sung, or the presence of source, where it has been denied, and war is a purpose, and war is a supreme act of the denial of the source of all things, you can reclaim even that, and lift to a higher plane, Now a higher plane is simply a different resonance, when you know who you are, which means realize who you are, in a higher way, you know the same for the others, on the other side of the wall, beyond religion, or ethnicity, or even historical data, and you must underline that here, historical data is a culprit in some ways. You think you are what you were. What happened 1,000 years ago, You think your last marriage. Or the failed attempt at career. You are not those things. You can claim all things in a higher way. way, but you cannot do that when you're denying the source of all things. But you cannot do that when you're denying the source of all things. Oppression that I'm on. Oppression is the denial of the divine, the polarization you speak to. The polarization you speak to is simply an illustration, is simply an illustration of the separation you've accrued, of the separation you have accrued, you, all of you, with the idea of source, with the idea of source. If there is a God, it's someplace other. If there is a God, it's someplace other, not where I sit. Not where those people are, not where those people are, and exactly what I want to be, and exactly what I wanted to be. The divine self, the true you knows who it is and does not know borders or separation. In fact, until you realize that you are one, you will incur suffering through the denial of the divine, which is the source of this separation, period. And they're saying period.
They definitely had a few things to say about it,
I guess.
it's fascinating. Like, and again, I know you, and we've known each other for a while now, but people listening, you're like, yeah, I guess, like, you really have no idea what's coming through you. And that's something for people who've not experienced this with you before. It's kind of, it's a very interesting point to kind of point out.
It's dictation, really. I mean, you know, they've been speaking in the last number of months, you know, about things that we're all experiencing. I mean, I was on Maui, you know, when the fires were happening here, and, you know, and then there's all this stuff happening in the world, and they've been addressing this in their way. You know, they rarely address current events by name, although they allude to things. I know in the very first book, they talked about 9/11, and that's the only time I've ever heard anything like that. But they talked about it as an opportunity to rise above the need for revenge or to be the conqueror that we had been used to, and that it was an opportunity that was in fact missed by us, was to place ourselves in a new way. But they've been speaking to how we treat one another and how we care for one another or don't care for one another in very explicit ways for a while now. And I think every lecture that they've delivered in the events that I've done in the last 6 weeks have been very much along the lines of what they were saying now. But no, I don't know what they're going to say until I hear it. And when I start to anticipate it, they'll usually throw in a word that I'm horrified by just to keep me on my toes, you know, and they do that sometimes so that I don't get in the way or start anticipating the end of a word or a sentence because I'm in a rhythm, you know. I mean, if you were to say 'twas the night before Christmas and all through the, I'd want to say house. But if the guides say 'twas the night before Christmas and all through the rectory, they would do that to me only because I'd go, oh my God, what am I listening to? And it puts me back on track.
The one thing you said before was that we have to kind of unearth a lot of stuff that has been buried. And again, going back, you know, within the last decade, racism was a big thing that kind of just started to, things that used to be in the quiet corners or you hear in the back room or at a bar somewhere, people were wearing it on their sleeves and saying it out loud. And it's like very, and it was like, well, what is happening? And if you want to talk about digging up old stuff, I mean, what's happening in the Middle East is pretty old, talking about a couple thousand years. So until we really reconcile with those things, it's going to continue to be dug up and shown to us in many ways, correct?
That's what I understand. I think if you understand the idea that nothing can be brought to light or healed, and while it's, you know, being hidden in darkness, you can see some of the purpose of seeing what we don't want to see. And finally, I suspect how we're all party to this, because like I said earlier, I began to say, I don't create everything, but my consciousness is informing everything I see, and all of ours is. So we're all in agreement to this reality, and we're sharing experience in this reality, although we may be holding different views about what things mean. But I understand that as long as I'm in the experience of it, the consciousness that I hold is contributing to it. And that goes back to the simple thing of who you damn and what you damn damns you back, which is just vibrational accord. The guides teach this thing, they call it the upper room, which they say is the octave of consciousness above the common field. So we're in this octave that is our reality with its high and low notes. And I suppose you could say the low notes are hatred and war, what we would call evil or the denial of the divine. But they say there's an octave above, which is coexisting with ours. It's not some place. It's like any piece of music, they say, can be sung in a higher octave or played in a higher octave, and their work is transposition. So, you know, in the higher octave, I understand that things can be reclaimed and made new. And one of their old teachings on this, which used to surprise me, was you can't lift the evil man to the upper room because you've made him evil, which means you've aligned to him at that level of judgment or fear. And if you're doing that, you can't really transform it. So it's a real challenge to move to a place where you can see things without deciding what they should mean or have meant based on a lot of historical data, which is basically we're using as the context for every argument we might have. This is what used to be, this is what the guides talk about in Book of Innocence, is the idea that we're operating from memory, and all of our memory, they say, is tainted by this belief that we're separate.
So then do you see a lot of the stuff that's happening, whether it be racism, whether it be violence, whether it be war or hatred or division, these are ideas that you and I grew up with.
Yeah.
Like we were programmed with this stuff coming out of, you know, out of our society. This new generations that are coming up behind it, and not everybody, obviously, but our new generations seem to kind of be rejecting a lot of the stuff that you and I accepted because we didn't know any better at the time. Because
Absolutely, it was.
So do you see that these wars, these events, these things that keep happening, political and economic and all these other things that are going around the world, are the signposts for the new generation? And hopefully a bunch of the older generations will go, war is just ridiculous. We got to stop the violence. We got to stop
that's
the division.
That's what I hear, yeah.
Is that your thing?
That's exactly what I hear. I mean, I've been told that, you know, it's going to take four generations for us to begin to see something other, to see the outpicturing of the new. And that the kids that are being born, coming in, are coming in with a different level of consciousness. I mean, they're already rejecting binary systems and things that we thought should always be there, what it means to be a man, what it means to be a woman, what it means to be privileged. All of these things are sort of being re-seen and re-understood, I suspect. And hopefully, you know, for the better. I hear that's the case.
Oh, yeah. I mean, as far as like, you know, my kids would see, you know, when they hear this whole, you know, we're going to work for one company for 40 years and get a golden watch, retire, all that makes no sense to them. They just are like, what? It just is such a foreign idea to someone who has no reference point.
Yeah, exactly right. I mean, when I grew up, you went to college, you know, if you wanted to get ahead in the world, and now, you know, you don't want to be in debt. So,
because they've made college so impossible for you to
possible.
And now Google, by the way, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but now Google's taking kids out of high school. They don't even want a college degree. They're just like, no, we'll train you.
Oh, I didn't know that.
A lot of these tech companies are doing that now with this younger generation.
You know, I was a college teacher for 25 years. That's what I did, you know, and I loved it. But I was 50 before, 50 something, I think, when I finally paid off my debt. You know, it took a long, long time. I know.
It was insane. Mm-hmm. Do you or the guides have any guidance to offer about overcoming this hate and division that is being amped up by the events of the world?
Well, I mean, I think it's key to everything that they teach. And I think they addressed a little of it, but let me just see. They were saying you have to understand one thing. You are seeing a creation, decisions made in fear, the action of fear is to claim more fear, is to play more fear. Every choice you make in fear guarantees you more of the same. Judgment is fear, hatred is fear. Hatred is fear. Recrimination also is fear. Recrimination also is fear, a belief in the need to defend, or a belief in the need to defend, lest the awful thing happen yet again. Lest the awful thing happen yet again. You may move to a level of tone. You may move to a level of tone or relevance where you understand who you are, where you understand who you are first as a human being. First, as a human being, I have the right to be. I have the right to be. And then second, as a divine being. And then second, as a divine being, because I am all as. Because I am all is, all human beings are of the same source, are of the same source. And if you can perceive that, you're already healed, period. You're saying period.
How can we individually, what is the role of the individual in resolving and healing from these conflicts around the world?
Well, I mean, I think on a personal level, there's things that we do. I mean, we're accountable to all of our choices. And like I just said, and I do believe this because I've experienced this one out, if the action of fear is to create more fear and I make choices in fear, I'm contributing to the very things that I say that I don't want. To realize the inherent divinity in the one you would call an enemy or the one you would call other, to realize the dignity of their expression, whoever they are, and the value of them because they're a human being is a good first step. But what do we do practically? Depends on how you're called. They're saying it depends on how you're called. If you're called to, if you are called to act, you will act, you will act. If you're called to pray, you'll pray. If you are called to pray, you will pray. But the level of consciousness, you hold claims what you see, in agreement to it, The one who operates from the higher tone, reclaims what he or she sees, that expression at that level of expression. Understand what this means? Peace is claimed through peace. Not the antagonism of war, the action of peace. The action of peace itself is rejuvenative. The action of fighting is always oppressive, So you choose to fight. So if you choose to fight, you are making a stake. If you claim peace, realize peace, and then enact that. The world will change.
Beautiful. That makes a lot of sense. Now let's go to your book, The Book of Innocence, my friend. What was the focus of the new vision of self and life in The Book of Innocence?
You know, I never know what the books are. I didn't even know what the title of this one was until they delivered it. And then I was surprised because they've been teaching presence and being, and I was still grappling with what that was. And then they said, and here is The Book of Innocence. And I was like, what the hell is that? But they say that there is an aspect in all of us, which they call the monad or the divine self. You can call it the Christ within if you want. You know, there's a term for it, I suspect, in every sort of spiritual teaching, but that divine spark. They say that that part of us is beyond the idea of separation, does not exist there, and it's also beyond sin, which is something that they've never talked about really in their teachings, but the idea of sin as the denial of the divine, and that's really all it is. So the part of us that is innocent, truly innocent, is source. And that is the aspect of us that's seeking reclamation through us. And that doesn't mean, I suspect, what you would think of as, you know, sin, or, you know, they say blasphemy, if you want to use that word, is the denial of the divine, which is basically not a religious teaching at all. It's just saying God can't be where that terrible thing is. You see, the denial of the divine, they say, is the problem that we have. And the more that we deny the divine, and in fact, when we're encouraged to deny the divine, God can't be where that horrible thing is, we end up sort of exacerbating the darkness and not being the light and bringing the light to that. Now, you know, they've said that like prayer is the is the seeing of the presence of the divine where it has been denied. It's not when somebody says, oh, well, well wishes and prayers for the victims, as if it's a platitude. Prayer, they say, is an act that one does where you are reclaiming the divine where it's been denied. It's bringing the light to the darkness. And they say that actually has affect. It actually transformed things. The book that they just finished teaching is all about how matter is altered through this kind of work, you know, how the world changes through it being re-seen and giving it an opportunity to be what it was. So in some ways, what we're doing in this book is we're reclaiming who we are, being reclaimed as who we are beyond what we thought or what we thought our history was. And they're saying that's happening at an enormous scale. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at it this way, everything that I look around the room and see was probably named by somebody else. Like, that's what a chair is, that's what a window is. And all of these things are really structures, and the structures are made up, they say, of the same stuff, which is source energy at a lower level of vibration. The lifting of this thing is moving them beyond what they were called or how we thought of them, how we thought of the bad marriage and what made it bad, or how we thought of that terrible thing that happened when I was 9 years old that seems entrenched in my psyche. The reclaiming of memory itself isn't about deciding that things didn't happen or pretending things were not so. It's bringing the presence of the divine where it was denied. And that's what they say alters everything. I don't know if that made sense, but that's the gist of it.
So how do the guides talk about transcending our limited understanding of this world in general?
Well, that's a good one. You know, they work with these attunements. And one of the attunements, I know who I am, I know what I am, I know how I serve, they say is invoked by the divine self or the monad. And it is this aspect of us that reclaims everything. But the claim that follows that, again, claimed by the divine self, is the claim, I am free, I am free, I am free. Now, if you want to think of this as just words or jargon, it doesn't mean much. But if you understand what's actually happening, the divine self, that part of you or me or everybody, you know, that knows who it is and what it is and how it serves, or the God within, is free and knows itself as free and is consequently not bound by the architecture or the structures that we've invested in or we were told to buy into. The guides say nothing gets claimed, any form of manifestation, nothing is claimed until it's first claimed as a possibility. But all we know through our experience as the personality structure. The personality structure knows itself through historical data, where you grow up, what church your family went to, or, you know, mm-hmm. what your teachers said you were good at or not. All of this information that we compile and we operate through. And all of that stuff is sort of born through this lens of separation. When you begin to align to the higher, and the claim is a simple one, I am in the upper room, you know, and which is a simple claim. Again, it's the divine self announcing itself where it expresses, things begin to change. And they begin to change, I understand, because the aspect of you that knows who it is now being given sort of free rein to claim itself through all aspects of us, including the aspects that define ourselves through limitation. You know, I was always this way, it's always going to be this way. The world was always this way, it will always be this way, which is, I guess, somewhat nihilistic. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the possibility for the new must be claimed first before things change. But I don't think we're pulling ourselves up by our bootstraps. I mean, I guess I'm a believer in grace at a certain level, you know. And I know, when I was 25 and I hurt badly enough because I was a bit of a drunk and I prayed for the first time, and I've been raised an atheist, and I heard a voice telling me what to do and I listened to it, that was kind of grace. But I did ask for the help. I did make myself available to something. And I do think that free will is honored. But if the will that we have is sort of offered in a higher way, you know, and we become willing to know who we are beyond what we were taught, or how to talk to be in fear, or who to be fearful of, or how the world should look, we get something much, much finer. So many teachings out there, I think, about manifestation or about getting stuff. You know, I want to have a bigger of this, I'm fancier that, you know, because, and that's what the small self or the personality self was taught to aspire to. But the God within, or the true self, I believe, actually knows what we need. And it knows what we need both at a level of personality, personally me, Paul, Alex, anybody, but I suspect also understands what we all need. And if we can move to that level of potential, we can begin to honor each other. And then I think everything starts to change. And that's what the guides have said happens. But as long as we're trying to hide our crap under the rug, it's not going to, nothing, not much is going to happen.
So with this specific teaching, Paul, how have you applied it in your life? Because you have said an atheist and, and you know, we're skeptical of this whole thing for a long time. And to even to this point, even to this day, you're just like, I don't know what's going on. I'm just here. How does that work for you in your life?
Well, you know, differently than it used to, I have to say. My spiritual journey is an odd one. And I don't feel that I've arrived, and I certainly wouldn't walk around saying I was awakened or enlightened. I've done a fair amount of work now, and I'm not done, and there's more to do. But I don't think of it as work, I think, in the way that I used to. I think of it as an unfoldment of life, and that the lessons come through the willingness to be present for them. I'm living a life right now that I would not have imagined myself living, and I do know that. Even 10 years ago, I wouldn't have imagined it. So I work with the energy of the word in practical ways. And I'm working with the guides a lot as a channel, which means I'm basically taking dictation all the time. I don't always say that I'm their best student, but I'm not a bad one, because I've integrated a fair amount of this now. And I know where I stand in my way and where I'm stubborn. And, you know, angry that I don't have a partner yet, or that, you know, people die when I don't want them to die, and, you know, things happen in the world that I think are just horrible to see. I have all those human responses still. But I'm having a very different experience. It's all I can say. You know, I mean, a lot has changed. I'm about 100 pounds lighter than I used to be. I look
You look great.
10 years younger. I feel better. You know, but it's not just that. It's mostly I've come to an awareness, I think, of goodness in the world, you know, and in people that I don't know that I used to have. It's kind of that simple.
You know, it was interesting, like when you were doing, when I think one of our first conversations, you were saying that during some of your channeling sessions with the guides, they would stop midway through. Because you were like, sorry, we must stop for Paul now because Paul disagrees with us. We must explain this to Paul.
They do, and they still do it. I'm better than I was. In recent lectures, I was just doing a five-day workshop at the Kripalu Center in the Berkshires in Massachusetts. And they just were saying, we're not going to listen to Paul's questions today. We're going to do that. They're going to teach anyway. They'll listen to me later. And I'm kind of glad when that stuff happens, because I know then that the teaching is going to be challenging to me at a personality level, that I'm going to have disagreements to it, but also that they're in charge enough to run with their material, and they prepared a teaching for these students and they're going to deliver it. I still interrupt the teachings often, and in the books I do that as well, but I'm also, I suspect, serving as a kind of a proxy for the reader. So if I'm screwed up by something, if something doesn't make sense to me or needs more clarification, I may ask for it. And usually they'll give it to me. Those are the Maui birds in the background. So that's all that was.
I understand. And thank you so much for living in Maui. Someone's got to live there in Hawaiian paradise. So I appreciate you.
Happy to do it.
I'm sure you are. Now, can you interpret from the guides this concept of primal simplicity?
Is that a term of theirs?
You've never heard of the primal term?
But they might have said it and I've forgotten it. Primal simplicity?
You want to ask them?
I don't get anything in response to that.
All right, then. So
the truth of who you are is extraordinarily simple, the true self. And the true self, or the source of all things, come as you come as you, is also highly simple. You complicate everything that you can. You complicate everything that you can because you think you're in charge of everything you are, because you think you're in charge of everything you are. However, when you let go enough to let God be God, to let God be God, watch the miracles occur, period.
All right. Fair enough. Now, in what way does the Book of Innocence propose to shift readers' paradigms in their own personalities in life?
You know, they've already dictated a whole other book, which I don't remember either. So let me see if I can remember anything.
You mean the new one?
The new one. It's called A World Made New. Yeah, they finished that in September. So not long ago at all. How does it shift the readers? I mean, let me ask them, because it's their book. We would like to say only one thing. We would like to say only one thing. The belief that you have in reality is the belief that you have and what that you have in what reality is what is altered by this, is what is altered by this text. When reality becomes malleable, when reality becomes malleable to a new perception, a new claim, then the world will change. This is not done at the level of personality, at the level of the personality. It is not done through the small self's will. It's done through the application of the divine principle, of the active principle of source. Come as you, seeking reconciliation through you with the divine self that expresses as all things. God as all things. This is realization. It's a fundamental change in the very architecture. What do you think reality is? Of what you think reality is, period. Missing period.
You said something very interesting a little bit ago, that your personality will disagree with their teachings.
Yeah.
So which is another way of saying your programming that you've basically grew up with. How can it, from your opinion, from your point of view, and also the guides, if they have anything to say about it, how can we overcome this programming? Because I've always said, you spend the first 7 years being programmed, the rest of your life trying to deprogram yourself.
You know, I was sort of thinking about some of this earlier today, apropos of nothing. I'm actually supposed to write a memoir about, you know, how all this happened. And I'm sort of having been thinking about my past. And I was thinking about how ignorant I was in some ways, or just maybe naive or stupid. A lot of stupid things.
We all did, sir.
When I was a kid. But the idea that it would never occur to me to do that now, it's not part of this, how my mind works or how I see things. Is in some ways just the fruits of having lived. So is the question, how do we get past that? What was the question again?
Yeah, how do we overcome this programming that is really guiding, kind of like on autopilot through our lives?
They're saying yes and no. 40% is habit, 40% is habit, 40% is choice, 40% is choice, and the other 20%, and the other 20% is looking around to see what you should do, is looking around you to see what you should do based on this behavior, based on others' behavior. When you understand you have autonomy, when you understand you have autonomy, that the divine self can work with will, can work with the will, what no longer serves you can be seen, and then you can be delivered from it, or maybe transformed, or it may be transformed if it's no longer serving you, if it is no longer serving you. So the habituated behavior, while it served a purpose at some time in your life, but is now outgrown, can be left behind. You think you're the product of your history. And while this is true in certain ways, there is an aspect of you, the eternal self that always knows who it is and is not defined by its history, nor time, nor space. It is actually free in its choice. And its choice, its action, its expression, is to realize itself through you, and then all it encounters, God sees God in all of its creations, period.
Now, Paul, let me ask you this, because this is another question I get so much in the comments and in emails. People who are gotten to a place where their vibration and frequency has gotten so low that they feel that they don't have any other option out.
Yeah.
You know, where they really just want to exit.
Yeah.
Sometimes, do you have any advice or guidance, or did the guides have any guidance for people who have just, they feel like this is not going to get any better, that they're cornered, they're being boxed in, and they're like, why even continue, kind of thing? I get so many of these questions. I'd love to hear if the guides have any guidance about that.
I'll go to them in a second, but you know, I've been there. I know that, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, when I read for people, I step into them and I feel what they feel. I mean, I know what it's like, and I've stepped into people just before they've crossed. You know, I often get them when they still have a body or about to jump off the roof, you know, and I know the terror that's there and the agony that's there. And I've experienced, and I recognize it because I know those feelings. I've had them, you know, and my youth was hard. But I do know the benefit of sticking it out. And for me, my road was not rainbows and unicorns and crystals at all. I wish it was. I admire people who have that. For me, it was getting bumped around, but moved forward through those bumps. It was not a graceful passage. So I'm going to go to the guides about this because it's a really good question. We only say one thing. We would only say one thing. You're here for a reason. You are here for a reason. Remember, known to you yet. The reason may not be known to you yet, but you may ask for it. But you may ask for it and expect it to come, and expect it to come. Now, some of you would think that would be a vocation. Now, some of you would think that would be a vocation, maybe because you smile on someone. But it may be how you smile at someone. It may be how you treat someone. It may be how you treat someone. It may be how you care for someone. It may be how you care for someone other than yourself, other than the self that gives you the reason, that gives you the reason to go on beyond what you've known, to go on beyond what you've known when your focus is entirely on the self. When your focus is entirely on the self and the self is in shadow and the self is in shadow, you must reach for another. You must reach for another to call the light to you, to call the light to you. You may call to God. You may call to God. You may invite God in. You may invite God in, but you must also know, but you must also know that if you were born, that if you were born, you have a right to be here. You have a right to be here, not only a right, but a purpose, and not only a right, but a purpose. The true self as you, the true self as you is what we teach, is what we teach. We do not denounce humanity, but we do not denounce your humanity or what you experience in form or what you experience in form and the trials one undergoes. And the trials one undergoes as part of their passage, as part of their past, part of the learning soul occurs, is part of the learning a soul incurs. If you simply know you're here for a reason, if you simply know you are here for a reason, ask to be shown the reason, and ask to be shown the reason, let it come in a gesture, let it come in a gesture, in an encounter. Don't expect the thing to drop in up. Don't expect the thing to drop in your lap like a free vacation, like a free vacation. Let it be simple. Let it be simple. I am here to bring my coffee. I am here to bring my coffee, to sit with a woman on the bench beside me, to sit with a woman on the bench beside me and share our day and share our day. I am here to take the walk. I am here to take the walk, even though I don't know where I'm going, even though I don't know where I'm going, and trust more will be shown, and trust that more will be shown, because we promise it will. Because we promise it will.
You know, it was really interesting, because I know your backstory of how and when the guides came into your life. And it was at a moment where you kind of just, not say lashed out, but just like, I need something. You yelled out to the universe. It happened to me something very similar as well. Yeah. I was at the darkest part of my life, and I asked for help, and it came the next day. And that's happened so many times in my life, and that's something that is not talked about enough. That they won't interfere. The guides, your spirit guides, your angels, nobody's going to interfere. But if you ask for help, specific help, not the lottery ticket numbers, but specific help, it generally comes.
That's been my experience. And sometimes it doesn't come how I would have it.
Right.
You know, or it can be a complete rerouting of a life or the idea of what one's supposed to be. I had to let go of a lot, really a lot. And none of it I wanted to, by the way, none of it I would have chosen to. So I completely agree with you. We do have free will. You know, in 12-step land, they talk about people hitting bottoms, you know, and you got to want it. You got to want to stop. And I think there is truth to that. So there's this thing, say this, you know, there's this old Leonard Cohen song, you know, that I like. I like Leonard Cohen, you know. I was 12, I was listening to that stuff. I never stopped. But in that song, Suzanne, you know, and I wasn't raised with any religion. So, you know, the line in Suzanne was, and Jesus was a sailor when he walked upon the water, and he spent a long time watching from his lonely wooden tower. And when he knew for certain only drowning men could see him, he said, all men will be sailors then until the sea shall free them. And that spoke to me. Great line.
Yeah, it's poetry. You know,
it is poetry, but that was the feeling. And I think, you know, grace comes when we're in whatever, you know, I live on Maui now. My friends are all, you know, Maharaji people, you know, and you know, it's a whole other thing. And it's the same truth no matter where you go. You know, I think we're all looking for reconciliation with what we know somehow deep inside to be true. And I think those opportunities sometimes come when we realize that the way we've always done things isn't working anymore.
And it's scary to leave the comfort zone, even though that comfort zone might be painful.
Yeah.
It's like the devil you know versus
absolutely
the devil, right. The devil you don't. So for someone who is in that comfort zone of pain or of just, I'm not going anywhere, of stagnation. What advice would you or the guides say to get you out of that? Because if you don't do it by yourself, the universe is going to do it, and it's not going to be pleasant.
It's going to do it. It's going to do it. It's happened to me a few times. And
me too.
I remember it's happened like twice, maybe three times. Once I was really stuck. It was like in my mid-30s. I was so depressed. I was so stuck. And I was like, get me unstuck. And, you know, within like a month, like 3 weeks, my cat died. I lost my apartment. I mean, I had to move. I was like everything, you know, but it took me a lot to shift. It happened again later in something very, very, very similar. And it was growth and it wasn't comfortable. And I have to say, you know, I landed on Maui, not by choice. I was in Costa Rica working when New York shut down during COVID, and a friend said, I have a place you can stay here. And that's how I came here, expecting to stay for 2 weeks. I never left, but it was a rerouting of my life. And I think we have to be willing for that, you know, but I do think if you ask to be unstuck, get ready, because your crap might hit the fan, you know, but it's going to happen.
And also, I think what you said earlier was so important too, is it will not come the way you want it to come. It will not come exactly the same. It will come around in ways that you can't even see. And you might not see it for years later. You go, that's why that happened. And that's why that happened. And that happened. Do you have to be open to that? Would you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, but it's going to happen anyway, probably, you know, and then you get to live with it, you know, so.
Yeah. It's interesting too, because I hear, I've spoken to so many near-death experiencers, and that is the ultimate universal slap is dying. They're like, okay, you haven't heard any of the other messages we've sent you. We're gonna have to kill you now. Bring you upstairs, have a little talk, and then send you back down because you're obviously not listening.
Pretty good. Yeah.
It's fascinating. Now, out of all these books that the guides have written through you, which is the one that has impacted you the most?
Oh, gosh. You know, they're all speaking to different levels of consciousness as you sort of progress. So I Am the Word, which was the very first book, was a surprise because they said, we have a book to write. And if you take 2 weeks, we'll do it. And I didn't expect anything to happen. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until I typed up all of the transcriptions, I didn't even know how long the thing was, that I saw it was a book and it made sense and it made perfect sense. And then they said it will be published and it's, you know, and it was, and all those things. In some ways, and it's funny, it's the most gentle book of all of them. There's a book called The Book of Knowing and Worth. Mm-hmm. It's a very loving book. And it talks about how we've been taught to believe that we're not worthy of spirit. And that, I think, was a lovely book when it came through, and it came through so gently. Some of the books come through like, you know, you're on a bumpy airplane ride and you just want to land. So Yeah, but they're all doing their work in different ways, and people are drawn to the book that seems to be right for them at the time.
What do you hope for the Book of Innocence?
What I hope for the book, I hope that the people that are going to benefit from it will find it. Really, that's it. It's not my teaching, you know, and I don't think of these things as, there's not any real careerism involved in it. You know, I'm party to the birth of these books, and then they're out in the world and they seem to find their readership, and I'm grateful for that. And I'm grateful if anybody's helped by it. And I was saying, if, you know, I give the books to people sometimes, say, you know, they're not page turners. If you don't want to read it, don't feel pressured, you know, but when you're ready, it's there, you know, and that's still how I feel about all of them, really.
Now, I want to ask the guides a few questions I ask all my guests, because I've asked you these questions. I want to ask the guides these if possible.
Right, okay.
What are the guides' definitions of living a good and fulfilling life?
To be honest with yourself and others, period.
What advice, well, this isn't for you, Paul. What advice would you give your younger self?
They just said, we have no younger self. That's
for no, me. That was for you.
that's funny. I've never heard that. So let me say, what advice would I give my younger self?
Little Paul.
Yeah, basically, don't be so hard on yourself. It's going to work out anyway, you know? Anyway. Underline anyway, that's the word.
Let me ask you one other question for you. What is the toughest lesson you ever had to learn that took you the longest time to learn?
I think I'm still learning it. And what comes to mind is that I didn't have to be who I thought I was supposed to be in this world.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, to the guides. How do you define God or source?
All things, that's what I hear.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
To love another, to know God, to know God, and to become who you can only be in truth, and to become who you can only be in truth.
And Paul, where can people find out more about you and the amazing work that you and the guides are doing?
My website, it's just my name, paulselig.com. And there's events and links, and anything you could want is there.
Well, why I love you so much, Paul, is that you seem like the reluctant channel. I think you should have reluctantchannel.com. Because you're just like, there's stuff, there's a books, there's I do. You always have that energy since I've met you. You're just like, it's what I do.
Yeah, but you know, yeah, it is what I do, you know, and if I was a basketball player, which I'm not, I'd be saying, yeah, this is what I do. I'm a basketball player. You know, it's I don't think it's more noble than other things, you sure. know, and I don't think it makes me more special than other people. It's an odd skill set. Mm-hmm. And I'm happy to be in an employ with these guys that continue to show up and work. But
you know. By the way, do all of us have the ability to channel?
I think we all have the ability to access our intuitive natures. I think, I suspect, I don't know, yes and no. They're saying yes and no. It depends on what level you want to channel. It depends on what level you want to channel in. You can be directed by other beings. You can be directed by other beings. And they're not all very wise to listen to. So if you wish a high being, or high teacher, or a high teacher, you must be developed for it. You must be developed for it. It doesn't happen instantaneously. Some may be born with great capacity, but there is skill facility, that must be developed, to work with a high guide, to render the information accurately.
And where can people pick up the Book of Innocence?
Any bookseller or online, all the major booksellers should have it.
And do the guides have any final messages for the audience?
Trust yourselves enough to trust that you are worthy of living a life, that gives you joy, Trust yourself enough to know that you can live a life worthy of love, and trust that you can live a life, and trust that you can live a life in service to higher, in service to the higher, without negating the joy of being in a body, in consort with fellows, and on this earth, period.
And do you have any final words for the audience?
No. I don't.
Paul, Paul, it is a pleasure and honor always, my friend, to speak to you. I look forward to our next conversation. Thank you for everything you and the guides are doing in the world, my friend.
You do too, Alex. Thank you.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.